Now, when you get to Kubernetes, it'll be different, I guess.
Well, it'll be different because we use that same YAML definition file.
That'll be the same, but...
Yeah, exactly. It's like a standardized interface. So
nice.
I think right now it's just like a separate flag because it's in trial. It's like, yeah, I'm gonna try Kubernetes, and it'll deploy everything that. Semantically, it's the exact same, but behind the scenes, they even adapted it to handle some of the old legacy Windows things, just get the AWS. They have like a plugin module that'll bake an AMI instead, and, you know, make it normal auto scaling proof and stuff like that. Hmm. But it's the exact same YAML config file that everybody else would use.
Cool. Do you have any idea what you're going to use to manage a, like, Kubernetes cluster, or is that still pretty early?
I'm not heavily involved in it. I know they're doing it with Puppet.
Okay.
AWS details beyond that.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I'm just going to steal. We're working on similar things.
Yeah, I think, I think it's entirely every man for themselves.
Yeah.
When it comes to that, unfortunately. There's a lot of promise in the new EKS, the managed Kubernetes that they announced at the latest AWS reInvent.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I actually didn't know if that's what that was.
Yeah.
That was just recently?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. So EKS is pretty promising.
Yeah, it was bound to happen.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
Everyone else is doing it. So
I think it's only available in one of the US regions right now.
Okay.
Yeah, this will be pretty good.
Cool.
In the back.
Do you guys maintain multiple repositories, or do you use like a monolith repository?
We do multiple repos. People have, like, debated back and forth about doing a mono repo because that's another way to address this, right? That's how like Google and Facebook handle versioning and things like that. You can just literally do a rep over your entire code base.
I know a lot of large organizations with big, especially with lots of separate services that depend on each other. It's a good way of being sure that all those APIs, all the contracts are in agreement when you make changes.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a route we've looked at here and there, but despite the fact that we have like internal tooling teams, we still have a strong desire not to build as little as we can. You know, so we still rely on any AWS managed service. If that'll work, that should definitely be the first choice if we do that. It's just like for anything else, so we just use GitLab in the background. And you know, a lot of the big guys, I don't know if Google's ever open source, the Czar is a sort of build service. I don't think they've ever open sourced anything they use. But yeah, we've just had really no desire, so we've kind of more adapted to the tools as much as possible rather than making tools that does.
For your repository management, when you keep things like close to master, do you avoid some of the well-known like Git management processes or tools like Gitflow? Because I know people have been moving away from that. So like trunk-based development, do you adhere to any standards or practices with that?
Yeah, like I said in there, we just try to keep it as simple as we can. So we just do a single feature branch. We're trying to push more and more like internal open source. So if our squad needs something done because they're, you know, maybe blocked them on another one for some reason, they'll start a new branch, fire a merge request, and even internally kind of everybody does that. You know, so we pair here and there, but then we also do a lot of merge request-based reviews. So yeah, we don't do anything big. Just keep it very simple and just try to make those feature branches as short-lived as possible. Because ultimately, code that you commit for that is in front of the customer. And it still happens, you know, every once in a while you see a branch has been 3 months out of date and somebody abandoned it and they're like, oh, we gotta pick it up, but it's all the way behind, so it's like just scrap it and start over again. So as much as we can, you know, kind of within a few hours or a day or less.
So are you still on EC2? Are you guys still managing VMs, or are you?
No, we're on ECS for pretty much everything. There's some of the legacy Windows stuff they have running on EC2, auto scaling groups. But otherwise, it's all, you know, like a single managed ECS cluster. And if you have some reason to be outside of that, which a couple of teams do, they manage their own. Like we have one for security requirements, just to keep it away from everything else. We just manage our own clusters for that. But then everybody else, you know, just point your slingshot thing at the YAML, and just like which cluster ARN am I going to? And you just point at that shared cluster, and it goes and you know,
how how big is your the developer UX team to be able to manage all these central tools?
I don't have a hard number. There's, so again, with that tribe squad thing, there's a tribe, like a developer neighborhood tribe, and that's made up of, I want to say, 5 or 6 teams, and each one has about 5 people, so roughly about 30 people. And of the 900, I think we're pushing 1,000 person headcount worldwide, I think a little more than half are engineering. So that's about 30 to handle about 500, 450-ish engineers.
You mentioned you're doing rollbacks, so and pushing out to like 1%. Have you guys ever actually done a rollback? And when you do, is there like rollback scripts for databases and stuff like that?
Yeah, so the databases, we just do, we handle those separately. The code deploys, yeah, the rollback's automatic handled by Slingshot because essentially it's doing the full blue-green, so rely on scaling. So we can just scale up and you have 2 versions of your service running. We'll say 1%, tries a new one, check the metrics on the new one, if the problem, just stop pointing people at it. So essentially the rollback is, you know, just the load balancer switches back to the old cluster and the new one stays there, so it doesn't do anything until you go deploy again. But that's all like on that shared cluster service and it's all handled by the tooling for us. Database wise, every team kind of does it. They haven't addressed that much. I think Flyway and other tools are making a bit of a headway, but essentially it's just like anything, any API breaking change you make, you know, you make it backwards compatible. Do your code deploy, does it look good, do the database change, and then clean up any code you have.
Do you guys make the all the code commits, like do you test the rollback scenario as well, or is that?
Yeah, like all the time, essentially. Like if I push a piece of code out, you know, and either maybe I added something in there, caused a bit of latency or user errors or any number of reasons, yeah, you'll see it goes out 1%, it'll clearly state that I rolled back for, you know, this reason, and I'll show you the metric, and you can just go right to the graph and see, okay, this is why I rolled back, and, you know, check it out, look at it, so, yeah, because again, because we don't do, we rely on it a lot more, because we're not doing as much, like, classic dev environments, because we just don't have a dev environment that's massive that we have to keep up to date, both with data and with, you know, worrying about load in it, making sure versions are different, and config and everything. We just rely a bit more on production and lean on that. So, yeah, there's a huge number of reasons I could fail and just roll this back.
So, where do you roll back to? Like, so ideally, you don't have to roll back a lot, but you just if you depend on it. Like, so you're on master already, so are you just on standby? Like, oh, we had to roll back, I'll fix it.
Right, so there's 2 ways to roll back, right? Like, my code can go out, it's going to go out to 1% of users, they're going to switch back. So, it's not affecting users. If you push something out and maybe you're not looking at a certain metric or it's just some bug that, you know, slipped through, and as far as Slingshot things, everything's good, so put 100% of people on it and you're like, oh shit, something's wrong, I actually have to do like a code revert commit, because we always do feature branches and merging, you eventually just revert, you know, whatever merge that code pulled in. And because we're constantly doing small chunks and that's very quick, it's not, you know, you're more likely to know what caused the issue is by the last commit. If you need to commit before that, you know, in the rare case where it's like, oh crap, this bug has been out there for 2 weeks and we just now noticed it, then, you know, maybe it's a bit more forensics. But in the vast majority of cases, yeah, you know, you can see that everything looked good and you catch up faster. So.
Regarding testing, you mentioned an emphasis on unit testing and then monitoring the metrics, but you guys have use much of a system test group to make sure that not just the intermediate fix or change works, but then the, you know, the trickle down to the back end systems.
You mean like across multiple systems?
Yeah, like if you make a change, yeah, you see it, but then if you go to retrieve it, did it retrieve correctly? You know, so you need more of an end to end.
Yeah, so for some of those environments, it's a combination of like a thinner dev environment, or we might do like a very happy path of, if I submit this, let's do it, rely a lot more on that potency. Like I said, a lot of our systems are kind of get only, or the bits that are get only. So, you know, we'll put it out there, but there's no data that's being manipulated. And then the systems that do manipulate data, to kind of do a bit more of a strict pattern of writing into the event log first and grabbing off that. So if there's a problem, you can always just kind of replay those events where you had issues.
Those internal tools that allow you to roll out updates to your project, like the logging libraries that you have, all that stuff, does it do transitive dependency management for you?
As far as?
Like if you have different, like if your project has sub dependencies that depend on the same thing, but different versions of it, does the tooling figure that sort of stuff out for you?
No. So it's something that they're working on now, and I think ultimately it's pretty dumb at the moment, right? It's just going to crawl over the code base and realize, okay, I know these three projects are on an older version of some circuit breaking library that we use, so I'm going to pull them down, literally pump the version numbers, and then submit them, and then all the testing will run as usual, and it's going to try and go out, like, through the normal code paths. I think we rely a bit more on the projects that are using that, the fact that they're updated more frequently. But you're not going to be super far behind. But then, yeah, we're kind of relying on, you know, a compilation failing or a test failing or a metric bombing out pervious users. And then again, they, because they're treating it like in a whole as 1%, you know, so as we do 1% of users for a single service, because they're affecting, you know, 50 services, they're going to try one service first, and did it go out okay? Okay, we have a bit more confidence, and maybe I'll try 5 services, and did they go out okay before I roll out? Yeah, we've not run into it yet. I'm sure that's about how it looks like.
So you mentioned earlier that you guys do a lot of A/B testing and you have features that turn things on and off. Do you have any tips on like cleanup of those A/B tests and feature flags? Like old code that's not around and database full of things set to A/B?
Discipline, unfortunately. I think, like that tool that I have, that I was talking about, that code lift that kind of, you know, can look over code bases, that could be a potential solution, but ultimately, because we're trying to do, like each squad is looking at one thing at a time, and trying to get out there as quick as possible, in theory, we've kind of proven that it worked or hasn't, so we try and focus on removing that flag before we go to the next one, but yeah, other than just discipline, standard like reps across your code base, I guess to see what's still running. The tool itself, the Dr. Jekyll that I mentioned, I mean, you can see what experiments are still outstanding, so you can see what's running, what stopped, what worked, what didn't. So you can use that as a quick guide and see, and everything ties back to that. You can be able to do an A/B, so you can quickly see your code, you know, some config value. You can look it up in that Dr. Jekyll and see, is it still a thing that's running that somebody's using? So I can at least tell you if it's ready to be deleted or not being used at the time or whatever.
Since you rely, you said you rely heavily on unit tests or integration tests, do you have anything to test, or, like do sanity checks to prevent from running into false negatives? So, you know, you roll something out, services are all green, you know, pings are green, all the metrics that are coming in, so everything's green, but there's maybe data is being manipulated in a way that's changing it how it shouldn't be?
It's a lot of, I think that the biggest thing that I found that helped with that was that alert equals spout. Because again, you know, it's a classic like, yeah, I think everything's working fine, but my consumer, for whatever reason, thinks something's totally off for his consumer down the road. So looking at that more than anything, a lot of squads start to play around with like parameterized unit testing and those kind of more exotic testing tools to see what works and what doesn't. But then a lot of it is because we do the feature flag first, you can, you know, just do a percent of users and see how it affects them before you roll out to everybody. So it's kind of like I mentioned with the chaos testing we tried to look at the last three. It's the same thing with new features before it's rolled out for the more general population. So they do slip through, but it's just, you know, affecting fewer users, getting your book very quicker, figure it out quicker, this is a smaller feature and all that stuff. So definitely it feels a bit more like running with scissors a bit, but then it's more like in a controlled manner, I think. And I was really uneasy with it when I first went over. projection that I came up with, there was an answer for it somewhere. So
it's just like lots of small safety scissors instead of one really.
Yeah, there you go.
Micro scissors.
You still get stabbed.
If I understood correctly, I think you said you're not using this for your mobile app server changes, right?
We use a good chunk of them, but yeah, things like Slingshot, we can't. Well, the actual like UI, the actual native app itself, you know, just because like iOS and Android store in their release cycles. They do more of like a release train style format. So every week, I think every Thursday, they'll do a code. Wednesday, I think, they do a code freeze, and Thursday, they'll push the app off the store. So there's like weekly releases of that.
Oh, they're doing weekly client changes.
Yeah, exactly. But then they still follow as much as they can everything else. They still heavily do like A/B testing inside the app. So they'll call back to the server, like an app startup, I believe, to get, you know, config values and what cohort am I in, what experiment should I run, so that they can still limit issues with that, right? They can still just have a couple of apps turn on a feature. We've done that a lot, especially like with the new login feature going out with it. We push it out there, so everybody kind of updated to it, and then we just turn it on for a small percent of users to see what happens.
Yeah, because I was thinking for the server side changes for getting the client, I would think this would still work.
Yeah, for
the browser, as long as you have some client that's hitting the right region that you've enabled for it.
What's that?
As long as you can have some mobile device that is hitting the right server, so if you're only enabling that for a certain area,
yeah.
You need to direct your devices there.
Yeah, and they still get, I know for the web UI, we essentially do a cookie out to know what cohort you're in. For the native app, I don't really know what the exact equivalent is, but I know there is one. But you'll write something so you know, yeah, this is the stuff I expect. So whatever, you know, gets passed on that whole call chain down the microservice stack, so their service says, okay, this guy should be in this experiment. So if they care about that experiment, then they'll do what they have to, and if they don't, yeah, you know, they just go through the normal flow. Yeah.
Do you use the feature flags to do internal testing in production?
Internal testing in production?
So
like in-house users trying something?
Yeah.
Yeah, we do that as much as we can too. In fact, one of they're focusing a lot more on the concept of the high frequency travelers, so the people that travel a lot for business, you know, being able to remember them and their preferences and all this kind of stuff. And some more people internally, like, because we have so many offices, they fly around quite a bit. So some of the features when we first got it out there, the first stab at it, you know, we released it to them first, they gave it a go and they gave us feedback. But we do it when we can, but then we're also kind of aware that there's always that bias of, you know, you use the app and, you know, we know how it flows and maybe we know a bit more about the industry. So it's like you get feedback, but it's, especially from a UX standpoint, it's a bit different than end users, but where we can charge it.
You mentioned that you try to keep a small backlog.
Yeah.
Do you have any tips around that as well? Like, are there like expiry times on project proposals or something, or limited departments?
We've actually done that, yeah. Every once in a while, we just almost clear the backlog, because inevitably we end up with things that were on there for, you know, 8, 9, 10 months, and you can see like people spend time thinking through this, and you know the context has changed. That thing's not no longer needed. If we didn't want to still do that, you know, we kind of have to rethink it. Say, I live with every quite involved. There's not like set cadence, but every once in a while we've gone through and realized like, okay, I think it's just getting a bit too big. Let's just delete it. There's a tool we use called realtimeboard.com. So it's the best virtual equivalent of a whiteboard I've ever seen. So we just have like basic post-it notes and things like this. So we use them and we just try to post-it note for things and start to realize like, okay, this thing's just getting massive. You know, let's just quickly go through these, or maybe at some point just cut it off. And kind of help us back up. Some squads, you know, still have massive backlogs. So it varies, but I think a lot of people are more and more just starting to figure it out.
So where most of the, a lot of what you shared was DevOps, where did a lot of those ideas come from for the internal? I guess I'm curious about the distribution. You're obviously going to have devs who care a lot about DevOps. You're not devs who, you know, kind of just want the ecosystem to take care of itself. Did those kind of come out from the external teams? Are there teams that are just focused on that and kind of driving improvement?
I think a lot of it came from a lot of the benefits that I mentioned, especially like around being on call and the systems growing out from that. So there are still people that kind of more enjoy that. So maybe they just work on internal tooling that isn't one of those first class services I mentioned. And there's no requirement to be on call. And as far as tooling, I don't want to slot this, but I mentioned it, but with a lot of this internal developer enablement tooling, it's really great because I can get a new service stood up and pushed out, and you know, rollbacks are handled for me and all sorts of stuff. But you don't really know what's going on under the hood. So if you don't care what's going on under the hood, it's great. You know, it just like it works. You can consider it magic if you launch some other layer of abstraction. But then I believe if you want to dig down deeper, you know, it's the same. If you care about how the CPUs or the OS is managing your memory, you can go figure that out. If you don't, you don't. If you're on call, people just tend to do it more because at the end of the day, there could be a problem in that system and you have to know how to debug it, how to troubleshoot it. But I think a lot of the benefits came from that. And it's just a cultural thing that we've been looking for as we hire new people. There's been people that they just turned down that were good engineers, but yeah, they said, okay, I don't want to do this. And it's just, as a company, I guess, like a stand that they took, that you know they want people that are a bit more interested to see how it plays out. And they try and do it, you know, as humanely as possible. It's not like a, you know, you're going to be on call and it sucks. You know, you have a pretty loose ETA to get things fixed, or SLA, I mean, to get things fixed.
Help out the people running the experiments. Are those devs? I assume it's a little bit of a different, maybe more business background to know what it is that they're targeting.
Yeah, it's a lot of business people that end up running. You set up a new experiment, it kind of goes through and says, you know, what metric you're trying to adjust. It helps you get like the smallest number of users you can get based on the amount of throughput and your parameters, like this market and this such and such. So it'll tell you like, oh, you have to run it, you know, maybe 1 week or 2 weeks to get enough users to know like a proper full experiment. Yeah, a lot of times it's the business people that go through and put them in there. And then we'll control kind of like when it starts or stops, obviously the code itself does. But yeah, they'll go through and set them up and report on and get follow-up and stuff.
Yeah, so I guess what kind of dashboard would they have to kind of see the results trickle in and how it
works? That's a nice internal dashboard that shows the whole thing. I think I had a screenshot at some point, but it was too busy to make it small enough. But yeah, it'll be for each experiment, there'll be a tab kind of showing what the current results are, what their expectations are, and then the output at the end and the learning so they can attach to it.
And they're kind of required to set up the expectations at that time?
Yeah, like as you, when you make a new experiment, it's like one of the required fields. And they're still, so we have like the idea of like a config service, so a lot of squads in the views and you just turn something on and off right now, but maybe you just want to see, you know, is the traffic gonna kill me type thing. So we're kind of working on more configuration service to handle that, so turn something on and off. So those things might just happen.